We have to be aware of what we eat. This idea that food doesn't affect us is certainly not true. And we also know the role of the certain foods affecting us relative to heart disease, relative to arthritis, even relative to cancer. So to have a natural, good, sattvic, harmonious diet is the foundation to good health and happiness and better physical and psychological state. We can't overlook this in our running after all the other things of life. We only need a lot of pills and drugs when we're not taking care of the foundation of life, which is the right diet and the right exercise. The process and practice of yoga, and here I'm speaking about yoga in the broader sense, not just the yoga postures, but all eight limbs of yoga, which includes the yogic breathing practices, mantra, forms of meditation, and the yogic values, nonviolence, contentment, the principles of a yogic lifestyle. Yoga is devised to aid in the development of sattvaguna as the first stage, which is to bring us to a state of harmony, balance, peace, inner relaxation, internalization of energy, heightened awareness, heightened perception, greater capacity of feeling, creativity. This is the foundation of yoga, which is the bringing the body and mind to their optimal states of functioning. Optimal in the higher sense of greater awareness and greater harmony with the world around us. Now, the ultimate goal of yoga, the second stage of and the real goal of yoga, is to bring us back to the purusha, or the inner consciousness, which transcends the gunas. So we have to bring the body and mind into the state of balance or harmony of sattvaguna so that they can serve as a vehicle to allow that inner self, the purusha, the higher conscious being beyond the gunas, to be reflected in us, to manifest through us. In other words, sattvaguna allows us to become, at a physical and mental level, the appropriate vessel for a higher awareness. So once that vessel is created, then the second stage, that higher awareness, that realization of the inner self, the divine presence within, can occur. Many people ask the question whether all these very nice and mild and harmonious sattvic qualities will interfere with our ability to achieve our goals and aims in life, which generally require more decisiveness, more energy, more action. First, we must understand that sattvaguna is also the mastery of rajas and tamas. In the state of sattvaguna, we know the right time to act. When rajas predominates, we're always acting, we're always doing, we're always making efforts, we're always trying to do something. And that is often not the best way to go. Because if you're always doing something, when the right moment for action occurs, you may miss it, you may be busy, you may be distracted. So sattva has the power of action that is the strongest, but it depends upon having the ability to observe, to know the right time in which to do things. So basically, a person who has sattvic qualities and energies can do anything better. They have the capacity that can be used for any type of achievement, should they wish to do that, because they are in mastery of themselves, they understand nature, they understand the environment. At the same time, these sattvic qualities may make it so that they may not be interested in all the achievements that, say, a person dominated by rajas would want to do. They may be, a sattvic person may be willing to do something more for higher purposes, selfless purposes, for the benefit of other people, rather than simply for the benefit of themselves. But sattva is not incapacity. It is the ability to do things when they are appropriate. If you are in a state of balance and observation, when something comes up, you know what to do. Say in a simple thing like driving a car. Driving a car, you have to remain alert. Then you know where to turn, or if someone gets in your way, you know how to avoid an accident. When rajas predominates, the person is distracted, moving, driving too fast, they end up in an accident. We've been discussing the three gunas mainly at a psychological or human level. As we mentioned in the beginning, the three gunas also have their function at a cosmic or natural level, in which each has its own place. So we can understand the gunas through the cycle of time. For example, rajas is the power that brings things into being. Sattva is the power that maintains them. Tamas is the power that destroys them. Or relative to the cycle of time, tamas, the darkness, is the night. Sattva, the light, is the day. Rajas governs, as energy governs, points of transition, sunrise and sunset, dusk and dawn, when we move from the day to the night, from the darkness to the light. There's always a transitional point of change, energy, fluctuation, or even turbulence. Now, in the ancient Vedic vision, which many traditional people have, they saw their experiences relative to what they called the three worlds. The earth, which is the material realm, which is said to be the realm of tamas, being matter, heaviness, inertia, and form. Heaven, the spiritual realm, which is the realm of sattva, the realm of light, the sun, the moon, the stars, the sky, space. And the intermediate realm, the third realm, the atmosphere, the realm of rajas, the realm of the storm, the clouds, the thunder, the lightning, the rain, the shifting phenomenon. So the gunas are also a model of these three worlds, which again are the world of matter, energy, and light, and light, or body, life, and mind. Matter is the body, energy is life, and light is the mind. So the gunas at a cosmic, natural level have many levels of expression, but the three worlds is an important one, and they can also, we can also find them in all cycles of time. All cycles of time have a beginning phase in which energy is strong, developing the quality of rajas, an intermediate phase in which there is balance, continuity, sustenance, phase of sattva, and then a phase of entropy, decay, leading to decline, destruction, death, or phase of tamas. So these forces pervade the world of nature, and part of working with the three gunas is being able to work with them in nature. So for example, one of the principles we learn is the importance of rajas in nature, in that intermediate periods are always very important. Sunrise, sunset, even in the human body, the space between the bones, the joints. Wherever there are these intermediate phases, transformation can occur. Energy is going to be active. Whereas the other two phases, the phases like the night, the tamas, or the day, the sattva, are going to be fairly stable, continuous. So the key is how to transform the energy to move from one to the other. So working with the gunas is also a lot about working with nature. And here, along with the three gunas, we introduce a related concept of the five elements. Five elements of earth, water, fire, air, ether, which represent the five densities of matter, not just the chemical elements. So earth is the solid state, water is the liquid state, fire is the radiant state, air is the gaseous state, ether is the state of space. So the gunas also relate to the elements. The dense elements have more tamas, the subtle elements have more sattva. Rajas is the active elements mediating in between. So part of working with the gunas is also being able to work with the elements to know each, give each its appropriate place, but to also be able to understand the subtle energies, because mind is a kind of space and consciousness is a kind of space even beyond the space of the mind.